better way to start your Thursday than with some Diana Ross? Nah, Roger's on the production there. He did what he had to do. Yes, indeed. This is the final Apples and Snakes at Home. Thank you so much for joining us, whether this is the first time or you've been with us for all the episodes. We're so glad that you're here to listen to some poetry. It's been an absolute delight being your host. And I'm sad this is the last one, but we are ending with an absolute bang. Yes, indeed. We have two of the most incredibly prolific, shy when it comes to the publication thing, poets. But what I love to see is that one of our headliners, Rachel Long, after so many people asking her, when you're gonna get a book out, when you're gonna get a book out, is gonna be having her debut collection, My Darling From the Lions, out this August 2020 from Picador. So we are so excited that she has finally blessed us with a publication that we can read from the leisure of our homes. So yes, our first headliner is the incredible Rachel Long, who has been Forward Prize nominated, people, for her first collection, no less. And we are really honored to have her read for us this evening. And our second headliner is the incredible Kayo Chingonyi, who is also a heavily, can you say that a poet is decorated, or is that just a war thing? I don't know. let's stick with accolades. He's dripping with accolades, people. Also one collection, but that collection made a big splash. It won the Dylan Thomas Prize and the Somerset Maugham Prize as well. And really, really excited to hear him read today. And to be quite frank with you, they are two of the most important poets we have right now. Black poets, certainly, but just poets full stop. And obviously we're in a period right now where people are very excited and keen to be hearing from us. And there's a spotlight on Black voices and Black poets that is necessary, but also unfortunately perhaps opportunistic. And I want to make it clear that, you know, it's not just about these poets being Black poets. It's about them having something to add to the canon in and of themselves, as writers, as thinkers, as human beings. And I'm really proud to have them here for our final Apples and Snakes at Home, as well as our last specially commissioned video from a new up-and-coming poet from Manchester. He is, let me read some of his credentials right here, because my brain feels like porridge and I'm forgetting things. I'm only 29, but let me tell you, I think it might be downhill from here. You know? I don't know. I'm trying my best. SAF-S2E is a poet from Manchester who describes himself as a poet writing dark, philosophical, and introspective work. So I'm very intrigued to see this video and what he has to offer to the canon. So we're giving you some established, highly accomplished, and experienced poets, and we're also giving you an insight into the new, fresh voices coming up today. So you're getting a bit of everything. And I'd love to talk to you also about the podcast that Apples and Snakes are producing, which will be focusing on Black Lives Matter, bringing Black artists together to discuss the various issues that are coming up at the moment that have, of course, been issues for decades. But certainly bringing that conversation into the fore, getting into the nuances, the complexities, how we move forward from here. If you'd like to hear more about that project, please do follow Apples and Snakes on Twitter, on YouTube, subscribe, and you'll be the first to hear about that podcast when it comes out. Okay, I know that you're gagging for poems now, people. I know I've gone on and on and on. But just wanted to get all of that out and done so you know what Apples and Snakes are up to. But now you get your poems. Okay, people? Yeah, you've been very patient. So we will start, first of all, with the absolutely incredible Rachel Long. So I've already told you about how amazing she is, but I want to just get into some specifics real quick, okay? Because Rachel, if you didn't already know, some of you will, is just one of the most pivotal facilitators and poets in this country, full stop, period, as the Twitter kids and the Americans say. So she is the founder of Octavia Collective, which is a really incredible and important poetry collective for women of color. And they are, I think, sort of headquartered at South Bank Centre. And her poetry and prose has been published widely, including in Filigree, Mal, Granter, and the Poetry Review. She is an assistant tutor on the Barbican Young Poets Programme. And as I've already mentioned, her first collection, My Darling from the Lions, is Forward Prize nominated. So that's one of the biggest prizes that you can win as a poet in England, nay, the world. So let's call a spade, people. Rachel Long is out here doing what needs to be done. She arguably is the Nile Rodgers of poetry. That one right there, I just decided to say it and see how it felt on my tongue. And you know what? It felt right. I'm not taking it back. Okay? So there you go. please welcome, for the delight of your eyes and ears, the incredible Rachel Long to read some poetry for us.
Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you.
That You're was welcome.
Too generous, truly. Poems then. It is so, this is the first time I'm actually reading from the book.
I'm so excited because
I don't have to waste time at a printer anymore, being like, my train's in like 5 minutes. Why is this thing like kicking it? Like, and then having to write up like on the train because the printer decided not to work and it was either the train and be late or no poems and in your own handwriting. Then you need to get on stage and can't actually read. I know I say for poets to take their time, you should take your time, I do believe that, but there's also having a book so you don't have to piss around with printers anymore. And that, honestly, everyone's like, are you excited? Are you proud? I'm like, I just really love that me and that printer don't have to go head to head anymore.
Publishing is about convenience. Yeah, it's about convenience more than anything. You know, it's the poetry handbag. I just want all my poems in one place, okay?
Yes.
We're very proud.
That's a beautiful way to put it. Open. This morning he told me I sleep with my mouth open and my hands in my hair. I say, what, like screaming? He says, no, like abandon. Night vigil. I was a choir girl, real angel, lightning faced and giant for my age. Mum let us stay up late if we went with her to night vigil. It started at midnight, a time too exciting to fathom how the minute and the hour stood to attention. During three members' prayer, my sister fell asleep under a chair, so she never knew how I sang or how I fell silent when the evangelist with smiling eyes said in his pulpit voice, "Hear, child." Had she woken, I would have told her, "Sleep, sleep," so she'd never know smiling eyes also meant teeth, or that he had blown candles for hands with which he led me down an incensed corridor, and I followed.
I'd love to ask you something about the type of writer you are, and do feel free to correct me if you feel this is an unfair estimation of what you're doing, but the thing that I find particularly interesting about your poetry is the sense of restraint and the poetry that lies in between each line, all the things that aren't said that seem to almost simmer underneath each line. So the thing that really stands out for me is restraint. I feel like there's a lot of things that maybe are on the cutting floor in your editing process, or do you feel like you're always someone who writes succinctly? You're not having to trim away necessarily. I'm interested in whether you are just a slight writer or whether you have long, great big drafts that become these very distilled and succinct pieces.
It's a good question. I think it depends on the poem. I think maybe naturally I'm more inclined to be too much rather than yeah, the whole less is more thing is something that I feel like I learned a little bit later. But I think in the draft process, that doesn't matter. You need to, like, getting everything out, and I think I still do. And then I go back and think, have I said too much? Can I say that in a different way that's not as maybe on the nose? Or maybe there's probably a little bit of a shyness as well, which I think is maybe quite kind of natural to me anyway. So maybe there's that comes out in the work too, actually.
A reluctance almost to reveal too much, to expose too much. It's interesting because, of course, there are those that would argue that these received wisdoms such as show, don't tell, or don't be on the nose, aren't necessarily unquestionable virtues of good writing. You know, some could argue that they are the notions that we have been given from the Western canon of writing. I'm not saying that that's how I feel, but that's what some might argue. How do you feel about that?
I think that's true. I think I'm very aware of that when I give like the newer and or younger writers that I work with, like, advice. I think I'm very aware that some of the advice that I give, if it was to truly be, like, really interrogated on where I've learned that and who's told me that and how I write, like, how much that's been influenced by academia, by poets from a certain school of thought, my tastes, what I read, what I've been told is good. I'm aware of that. I don't have an answer for that.
But it's interesting to think about, isn't it? And I don't believe in objectivity. I don't believe in being able to step outside of oneself as a poet, as a facilitator, or any of that. I think you can only ever acknowledge and gently poke at your biases or your inclinations, but not to the point where you just don't trust yourself and what you have to offer as a tutor or as a writer. So I think you're pretty much in a good balance between being self-critical, but also just saying, well, that's just how it is.
I think I'm always very careful to be like, it's your poem at the end of the day. Like, I say this all with love. And I say this all this is like genuinely what I think, but it's what I think. And you are your own poet and you're your own person. And you can take what I've offered and run with it. You can add a little of your own spice. You can, but yeah, I think being aware of that is good. I don't know. It's a really good question. Probably said I'll be thinking about it for a long time. Kayo, what do you think? Can I ask
her? Yeah, Kayo, I'd love to get your 2 pence on this if you're willing to offer it.
Yeah. So you mean around, like, I don't know. I feel like it's you have to try and be the poet that whatever poem you're working on needs. And that poet is always narrowed down by your own experiences, reading whatever you think of as good. But for me, at least, like, what I think of as good has shifted and changed over time to where initially I might have missed entirely what people see in a particular poet. And then over time, I start to see the virtues in there. Work. So I try and remain as open as I can to those processes and changes in my own writing, but at the end of the day I do end up writing about, like, similar things. Although I try and take a new perspective, there is still the connecting medium of my own psyche, and my psyche is obsessed with the same things, or at least it is for this particular span of time. But who knows what it will move to in the next span of time that I am inhabiting as a writer. I don't know. And I want to remain open.
I totally agree with that. Frustration slash acceptance of the topics that one continues to circle as an artist. I used to think that it was because I just was very limited in my scope of interests or intellect, but then I have a quote stuck on one of my exercise books from Albert Camus, and it's, a man's work is nothing but this slow trek to rediscover through the detours of art those two or three great and simple images in whose presence his heart first opened. And what I love about that is it made me feel better about the fact that I basically just bang on about the same three or four things, but from different, like you say, Kayo, from different angles. when I step outside of my poems, I'm like, rah, babes, you really just be on the same bullshit. You just talk about the same things. But I think most artists are the same. When you start to look at their oeuvre, you see the same themes and ideas and motifs pop up again and again. We're going to get totally lost in the source here. So Rachel, let me pivot back to you and some of your poems. Would love to hear a few more, please.
Yeah, maybe this is after that conversation, like a good, I feel like I was always trying to write this poem and then I stopped trying to write it. And then it came out, but years later, and it wasn't until I wrote it, I was like, oh, it's this. The clean white bowl of it, the pile of it. Imagine eating all the snow you've ever wanted in one sitting, not having to pay for it. The avocado of it, toast butter cascading your fingers, pink Prosecco, you'd be spaced out. Clucking, grumpy, sexless, you'd die without this, clutching your ribs in the dark, one street from home, footsteps gathering. I know a place that is snow falling from an Artex ceiling into a room you will never return to. A promise, piling like cable net, four ply snow day snow. I know a place where the sad can't go, where I'll never have the right footwear. Here you can throw it all in. Go on, baby, give it back to whence it came. Dispel three dinosaur dinners like forgiveness, like it never happened. Bile is the bottom, ground zero. There is no more after, no more. Girl, you can be new. Surrender it all into one bowl. This, your hollow.
Thank you, thank you. More, darling, more.
Do you know what? There is something about the printed out pages that you don't have to flip. You just...
I hear you on that. You need to invest in some sticky notes. That's the one.
Yeah, publish a collection, buy sticky notes. Open. This morning, she told me I sleep with my mouth open and my hands in my hair. I say, what, mom, like screaming? She says, no, baby, like abandon. Apples. Last night, I missed my train by seconds. So close that one part of me did catch it. And waved from the window to the other half, still panting on the platform, tits play-doing out of a shit bra. I couldn't sleep for an hour and a quarter, the exact time between the two slices of me, reaching home in separate taxis, each driven by a brother who co-owned the firm. Today, I'm assuming the recovery position in my favorite outfit, a jumper with just knickers, the perfect hot-cold combo like a bowl of baked crumble and ice cream. I'm magazine educated, so I've known for a while now that my body is an apple. Supporting theory, I bruise so easy, I worry it's leukemia. No, the doctor says again, it's just your dark skin. She recommends scar serum. When I was bored after service, mom still counting the collection, then insisting on sweeping from altar to street, I'd sit in front of a pillar, playing with my brain Barbie. She was brown with tattoos, and I made her have sex with a grown man in a toilet cubicle. I don't remember her face or her body, nor what I named her. Something beginning with N. When the mom of my then best friend said her daughter wasn't allowed to play with me because I was another N-word, meaning mom went round in her dressing gown to slap her silly with her tongue, then returned to scatter the kitchen and shred dad's guardian for not sticking up for us, for never saying anything. After that, I had a sleep dream in which I grew a bright green face, Granny Smith-hued, high polished. And even though I was green, I was the most beautiful woman in the world. I had the best hair and even did humanitarian work. I was interviewed about both things each night for TV.
Mm. Yes, Rachel. I love that. I love that. It made me think of two things. The Sliding Doors classic with Gwyneth Paltrow. And also the Selma, I think it's a Selma Hill poem where she's like, I'm a cow now. You remember that poem? When you started talking about, you know,
which collection?
With what, sorry?
Which collection?
Collection, because I read it in an anthology. But that,
ooh,
that
I that, love that, Selma.
Yeah, that surrealism of, you know, well, I'm an apple and, you know, this, you know, I had this beautiful hair. Reminds me of, well, I'm a cow now. And
I love Selima Hill.
Yeah. Just brilliant. There's so many things I want to say about your work and talk about and ask you, but unfortunately we don't have 6 hours to spare. But thank you so much. Please do. People don't need to pre-order at this point, do they? They can just.
No, I think because the date got brought forward, basically, that even though it's not the publication, that it will come if you order it, which is
okay.
People are like, I've got it already, and I'm like, oh, okay. Some people's came before mine.
So just go and get it, people. Order it, preferably not from Jeff Bezos's Circle of Hell. any other bookstore of your choice. I think all the pieces you read today were from the collection. Yes. So there you go. You've gotten your little nibble, your little sample. So now you want to go and get the whole thing. So I am going to lead on now to the quiz portion of today. And I know you two are clenched, right? You should be. To get real, okay? So there are 3 questions here. And I'm going to pose the question, and then I'm going to come to each of you in turn to see what you think. So the first question is, we're getting rid of the national anthem, okay? We're putting Royal Britannia in the sea, and we're going to write a new national anthem that represents the Britain of now, okay? But the question is, do you want it to have a garage or a grime instrumental? So, Kayo, I'm coming to you first. I know that you're somewhat of a connoisseur in these streets when it comes to this particular canon of music, so I'm really excited to hear what you think.
Do you know what? At a push, I would say a grime instrumental.
Okay.
Because grime, I think, is more reflective of like the character of the country sometimes. Like garage, I feel like, or at least the popular form of garage, is reflective of what the country is like when people have money and like the economy is booming and people are buying Moschino belts and bottles of brandy, and that's part of the country as well. But I feel like grime is what it feels like in Glasgow on a day that it's rained for like the 7th day in a row and you're late for work, and I just feel like it kind of. And also there's lightness and joy in it occasionally, but it's like brief.
Mm.
So I feel like it would be a grime instrumental. Ooh.
Kayo, come through with the critique. Come through with the seriousness. Wow. Let me tell you, that I I want the PhD. I want the doctorate. Okay. So if any people who work at universities are listening, you need to start laying down some offers for our guy to write the full thing, because we need it. Rachel, grime or garage, what are you saying?
I feel that what I say now is just going to be, I was going to be basic and be like garage, because that's what I got brought up on, you know, like, yeah. So that's why the new national anthem should be that, which is basic after Kayo's answer. Basic.
No, you know what? You're in good company, because Kareem also wanted a garage instrumental, and he spoke about the fact that the intergenerational aspect was also important. He felt like garage would bring different ages of people together more so than grime would, which I think is a very true point.
It is true, yeah. It's definitely true. And also, that's, like,
yeah,
that's exactly Ollie, what you're thinking, Ollie, Rachel,
oi,
right?
Oi in garage as well. Like,
what do you say, Kay?
Oli oli oli, oi 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 in garage is like, I mean,
that honestly transcends race. That call and response transcends race and exactly. class and age. It does.
The anthem needs a section that's just, imagine like it's the Olympics and someone's won a gold medal and their family's just giving it olly olly olly.
I don't want to imagine it. I want it to be our reality. We need to manifest what we want and what we believe in. That was a vibe. I really enjoyed those answers. Okay, moving on. This one is interesting. Let's see if you feel differently to the other guests we've had. Would you rather have brunch with Big Bird or coffee with Kanye? Rachel, I'm coming to you first on this one. What are you saying?
These are hard questions. Like, I thought you, well, this is kind of hard and not hard at the same time, but like, I thought you were like ice cream or...
Nah, girl, we don't play that.
Haribo's. No, okay. Brunch with Big Bird.
Yeah.
Or coffee with Kanye?
Yeah.
Brunch with Big Bird.
Coward.
There might be alcohol at the brunch, but just coffee with Kanye. If it was like brunch with Kanye, then you could start ordering like Bloody Marys. But otherwise, I couldn't have a conversation with him sober.
You can have an ickle bit Kahlua in the coffee. No one said
that. Okay, I like this coffee shop.
Yeah.
Maybe Kanye then. Like, if there was something on the menu that I could be like, okay, if this is going terribly and I can't escape, like, I could kind of find a way to get through it. And maybe, actually, do you know what? I do have some questions for Kanye. I have a lot of questions for Kanye. So
I'm saying, everyone's going for Big Bird, and I'm like, you're missing a juicy opportunity.
No, but it's just to avoid Kanye. Basically, that's just to avoid him. It's like Big Bird all day. Like, I'll date Big Bird. Like, me and Big Bird can like set up, but just to avoid Kanye.
Yeah, I hear you. We all want peace. I get it. Kayo, what are you saying?
Do you know what? I just wanna know what's going through Kanye's mind. Like,
I'm saying,
so even just a brief, like,
it doesn't have to be like a large latte, it could just be an espresso ting, but like,
yeah, just bruv, what's going on?
But the answers are going to be terrible, though. You know, we want to answer questions, but I think we know that the answers are going to be bad, you know, and therefore just true. Avoid that situation.
It's true. But if you're asking me between Snuffy and Kanye, then it's a wrap. I'm having brunch with Snuffy, because Snuffy...
Snuffy?
Yes. Snuffy the Snuffleupagus.
Also, sorry, you can't have brunch with Snuffy. You have to have something with Snuffy that is also alliterative. So maybe snacks or...
Snacks with Snuffy. I'm into that.
Or smorgasbord.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like Snuffy has a lot to offer in terms of, like, you know, mealtime companionship.
Okay, come through. Kayo, you're really
good. I know, good at the answer. It's much better than me.
Rachel, your contributions are also very...
Thank you. That's not true, but I will. Thank you.
Okay, so last one. I'm very interested to hear what you think about this, as two poets I hold in high esteem. Would you rather be a sick poet, i.e. the public and the critics en masse consider you at the top of your game, but you are constantly mired with the feeling of your inadequacy as a writer, or be pretty mediocre, but you're like vibes in, You're like, yeah, I'm great. Like, I write good things. Which would you prefer?
That is such a horrible question.
It's not a horrible question. Answer it. Come on. We're getting to the heart of what actually matters to you about being a human being. This is why I'm asking you this question. Rachel needs some time. Kayo, what do you think?
I'd rather be good at my craft and like unaware of it, because I think that's what stops you from being complacent. I wouldn't like to be like, I wouldn't like to be so lacking in self-esteem that I couldn't create stuff.
Yeah.
But I feel like a certain level of skepticism about your own abilities is useful.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, very measured, very interesting. So you want to be sick, but just ever so slightly fearful of your own ineptitude.
Yeah.
And by the way, that never goes away. This is part of that choice. You're always going to be like, oh, I'm not that good, really, am I?
I can live with that.
You can live with that. I mean, most of us do, to be fair.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm like, oh, you're just describing.
This is why I'd rather be mediocre and gassed.
Really?
Yeah, because it's all part of the capitalism complex, where we are always defining ourselves by what we produce and how we are perceived by others, and whether we are useful or valuable by these very particular metrics. And even within the arts, it's the same. It doesn't matter whether we're not producing something tangible or obviously useful to the GDP of the country. It's still the same mentality of like, I am only worth what I can give to the culture or to the public or whatever it might be. And me, I'm trying to like be content in myself. You know, I'd rather be content and mediocre, really and truly. And Black people, we internalize this more than anyone. It's all this Black excellence shit. Allow it, man. Like, mediocre and happy is the hill I'm dying on.
But wait, when you're, so the option of being gassed and mediocre, but when, if you know you're mediocre, how can you be that gassed?
No, because you don't know you're mediocre, but you are. Like, everyone believes you to be mediocre.
Okay, that's different. You're kind of delusional and you think like...
Yeah, but I think it's a vibe, you know? Inside, because this is the thing, man, like we all live in here. It doesn't matter how many people tell you you're amazing. We have to all live in our heads at the end of the day. So I'd rather be like vibing in here and just being like, yeah, great.
My poetry. But isn't being gassed and mediocre also a product of like capitalism and the capitalist condition as well? Or more so, maybe.
Yes, but in this version, I'm happy, innit? I'm smiling, I'm happy with myself, so I'm going to be nicer to other people because I'm not crippled with an inferiority complex. Like, when you don't like yourself or you don't rate yourself, you're not nice to other people. You know that. Like, anyway, I'm bringing too much of my own opinion on this. Rachel, decide for yourself which one you're going for.
Oh, definitely held in high esteem by everyone except for myself. Yeah.
You do not want joy. You do not want joy. Really. And that's on you. That's on you.
I feel like deciding to write poetry as a serious enterprise is not really like...
The pursuit
the
of the
most joyful thing.
Yeah.
The most joyful thing you can decide to do with your life. Like, I don't know. It can be, maybe, on occasion. Like you see those, you know, like those brief like those moments of when you read the poem and you're just like, this is low-key the best poem that I've ever read in my life. I mean, I've never had that, but like I have brief moments of like, yeah, this phrase though. This phrase is sick. And then you just walk. For me, that's like a good moment, or like the moment that like the new books arrive and I like just appreciate that for its own thing for a minute.
Yeah.
Like it's not in a bookshop, it's just in the house in my hand and I wrote it.
Hmm.
Or like reading your own book on public transport is...
I've never done that.
Trust me, it's joyful. No one knows that it's you, but you know, and it doesn't even matter if it's good or not. You wrote it. And
see, you're slightly in my camp, Kayo.
Sometimes, in those moments where I'm sat on a train and I'm like going to a reading, and I'm trying to decide what to read, and I'm reading my own book again, like after a long period of time, and I'm like, yeah, it's all right, you know.
Yeah.
Other people don't know this, but I wrote this that I'm reading. This, it's all right.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, the dream is to be good at what you do and also generally content whilst also striving to be better always in a healthy, sustainable way. But let's not act like, as you said, you know, we're poets, so we're not really particularly drawn to, you know, emotional equilibrium, you know. So we can dream, but we will never get there. So that concludes the quiz portion of this event. Thank you so much. That got heated, but I like it. I like it.
I feel exposed.
That's all good. So we're going to lead on now into our last specially commissioned video from SAF-S2E. And we are going to be joining you again to chat a little bit about it and then hear from Kayo right after this.
Lord, plague me. Plague me. Lord, plague me. History is history and fact is fact. Keep it public, keep it blunt, the plaque should read. This statue is of a being who built our city out of blood. His name not tarnished nor glorified, there is no sinless king. Indulge me and see loyalty in melanin. I heard a lesser blood in heaven sinned. I know Jesus' pieces never gave Jesus peace. As dropouts, we felt justified in chasing dreams, kinda like Martin did. But we ended up faded, misguided. We found solace at youth and bottoms up in clouded rooms under stroke-free fountains. Young forever, we thought us rich. But time was no currency, it strides in its own urgency to grow and see your identity starts from shallow skin. Maybe heaven really had sin. Maybe that's why we're promised. I tried to not curse in this, my existence might be blasphemy made. The Lord plagued me. Plagued me. Lord plagued me. Plagued me. Lord, plague me, plague me, Lord, plague me, plague me, plague me, Lord, plague me.
That video made me feel so nostalgic. This isn't a covert diss of the video quality or anything, but in the first few seconds, all I kept thinking of was those videos we used to take of ourselves back when phones were a lot more rudimentary than they are now. Those wobbly videos we take of ourselves walking down the street, going to the corner shop, chatting nonsense with our friends, whatever else. And it definitely felt like a piece that was about the passage of time and that bittersweetness of nostalgia. There was the line, time is its own currency, has its own urgency, and it definitely felt like a piece that was holding on to these romanticized parts of the past, but knowing that things have to move forward. There was a lot there for me that just gave me these slight pangs in the chest for what's been, but yeah, really, really, really lovely piece. Just, yeah, it's making me feel like it's 2005 again. Kayo, what did you think?
I really enjoyed it. It made me think about how there's a kind of soulful, inflected rap sound that comes out of Manchester. It made me think of that kind of scene. And also that crosses over very seamlessly with poetry in Manchester as well. So it's a very, to me, a very Manchester kind of perspective that's being presented. And I really like the aesthetics of the whole thing.
Yes.
Like the masks and the graininess and the kind of like Blair Witch Project type aesthetic, found footage, horror filmish. I enjoyed it. Yeah, and the hook was kind of haunting in a weird kind of way, which I also liked. I'd want to listen to some more of, I enjoyed it.
Rachel?
Yeah, haunting, I think, is a good way to put it. I feel like that's now not, that's going to be in my head now for the rest of the day. And those flashes of masks. A mask with sunglasses, like as an image, that's, I like it.
Yeah. The visuals of all the videos we've commissioned have been really interesting to observe, and they've all felt like they've nodded to the specific language of videos, which is it's only just coming into its own as far as something that we can analyze, I suppose, because the age of the internet evolved so quickly. But like the ensuing languages and shorthands of things like memes or selfie videos or social media culture and how that proliferates amongst us is really interesting to observe from a more analytical or academic context. So this video nods to a very particular time in camera phones, I think. And then we had something last week that nodded to makeup tutorials, and I feel like that's its own very particular language. I really like that we're leaning into these modes, and they're not just things that we disparage as what the young waste their time on. It's like a respect for it as a, its own specific and nuanced artistic medium. These videos have been really interesting to observe. I think poetry film is definitely having a renaissance. We're not just saying poems in front of cameras anymore. We're doing exciting things, which is great to observe. Thank you so much, SAF-S2E. We look forward to seeing more of your work in future. So let's lead on to the second headliner of this event, the incredible Kayo Chingonyi. I've known him a long time. He's a poet who, much like Rachel, bides his time. You know, he's not a fool rushing into anything. You know, the collection was hotly anticipated, and when it finally came, it just absolutely lit up the award world. He won the Dylan Thomas Prize and also the Somerset Maugham Award. He is the associate poet at ICA and the poetry editor at The White Review and an assistant professor at Durham University. He also has a new collection coming out called Blood Condition from Chatto and Windus, and also a memoir, Prodigal, forthcoming with Picador. So, bits. I think that's the official term for what he's doing. Bits. Okay, and more so than that, Kayo is a very thoughtful and considered writer and speaker. Whenever I've heard him talking, I saw an event he did recently, not so recently anymore, at Cheltenham Literature Festival on grime, and just whenever he speaks on a topic, he never just gives you the platitudes or the facile sound bites that we're used to hearing about things. He always offers a really rich, nuanced, complex set of thoughts. As you've seen, even with this silly quiz, he's coming and he's basically just given us theses. And I really appreciate having someone like him in our discourse at the moment, in a world that's just full of reactionary, flippant statements and supposed ideologies. I feel like he's a real antidote to the noise at the moment. So I'm really, really grateful and excited to welcome, for your eyes and ears, the incredible Kayo Chingonyi. Yeah. Yeah. God, I ramble
on. Thank
you
so much, Vanessa.
I mean every single word.
I appreciate it, especially since you are somebody and Rachel is somebody who I look to in terms of shaping discourse and leading discourse in a fruitful direction and like moving away from the noise of life. Both of you are interested in your work and in your personhood with a more intentional perspective. And I've really enjoyed the conversation we've had here, plus also all of the conversations over the span of time in which we've been at readings, not at readings, whatever else. So firstly, it's just really nice to be in your kinship, albeit in this mediated way. And thank you for your introduction. I'm really pleased to be able to share some poems. I'm going to read first a poem which has to do with a certain aspect of my own masculinity journey, which I've had to come to terms with over time. And this is from the new collection, or at least I think it is. We'll see. But this is called Hairline Recession Support Group.
Okay.
Our first meeting was in the fire assembly point of what was once the Red Studio on Ilford Lane, a ramshackle establishment run by a man rechristened Rambo on account of his likeness to a Tagalog-speaking Sly Stallone without the steroid swole biceps, with the mullet, a knack for power clashing. He never wore the same shell suit twice. DMX was there singing, "I want to thank you," while a barber scraped prison from his scalp with a pair of wool bald faders. Neo passed through, spinning out of his cape, rubbing his head as an elder rubs a painful joint. Ant McPartlin sent his apologies. LeBron James sent his apologies. Wayne Rooney sent his apologies. Jolyon Lescott sent his apologies. Our keynote speaker was Skin from Skunk Anansie, with a paper entitled Skin Dread, The Frustrations of a Bald Head Rasta.
Fantastic.
I think I'll read this poem, which at the moment feels to me like close to the heart of the new collection, a blood condition. And I'm thinking about a blood condition in the sense of family heritage and history being a blood condition, something that's passed through time, and the kind of figurative and literal meanings of the word blood. Plus, I'm also thinking about HIV as it's intersected with my own family history and the history of my nation, Zambia. So this is a poem called Heirlooms, which is thinking about some of the things we inherit. The steen with a chipped edge, you're sure you bought for a quid on Camden High Street, belonged, if you ask me, as well you might, to my mother, known all her life by a name she detested. What does it mean to answer to a misnomer, to feel the cold air between being and being seen? We have filled our house with her things. Alfred Meakin dinner set, cutlery etched with the indicia of the Newcastle Corporation, made in Sheffield by Firth Steelworks. A white drop leaf, crystalline glassware, a house-proud woman's cachet. I live in an artist's impression of the flat in Wandsworth. I cut vegetables with the knife my mother reached for in her rage. I remember the sound of metal scraping wood. The door I had just grown strong enough to hold closed.
Ooh. I cut vegetables with the knife my mother reached for in her rage. Holy shit, that's stunning. So I have a question for you, and I'd love to extend it to Rachel as well. And I'm thinking about how to phrase this succinctly. There's been an emergence of, I think, a loving mockery or parodying of what one might loosely call diaspora poetry, right? And I think that's the sign that something has arrived. When you can mock it, that means that it has enough leverage or enough of a body of work behind it in order to parody it. So in a way, I find it a stamp of approval. But I can't lie that I've had moments where I've thought, oh, am I contributing to something that's now played out or a bit trite? And I was wondering how you feel about what might be called the stylistic crutches or thematic crutches of poetry written by us poets of the diaspora. Do you feel like there's worthy critique of that, or perhaps a romanticizing or objectifying of a heritage, a culture that isn't ours in the same way that it is our parents? This is a question with like 17 questions in it. I appreciate that, but feel free to respond to whatever feels the most pertinent for you. Kayo, what do you think?
I think there isn't a need to critique these tropes that become predominant in any particular literary or artistic movement. And I think also there must always be the space to do that in the space of one poem as well. You might find yourself romanticizing the night sky in your, you know, motherland and like all of these kind of things. And in a way, if the poem is writing itself without you risking anything or anything much being at stake, then I think that's the moment to ask the question. Have I written this poem before? Has someone else? And what would it be like to write the true poem at the heart of this? So like, yes, I'm idealizing a particular perspective, but why am I doing that? And like, I feel like the poem written out of that impulse, out of that question, is of equal importance. But I do want to hear from people in terms of their perspective as part of a diaspora and their feelings about what home means and these kind of questions. Because I think while those things are becoming more part of the mainstream conversation, they're still not widely understood. I don't feel people truly understand, not even just double consciousness, but like triple consciousness or like quadruple consciousness, where people have several languages in their head and they don't know which one to think with, for example. I feel like those kind of conversations could be in poetry a bit more. And if we could go to the full extent of that complexity, then the poems that arise will always be refreshing.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on the double, triple, quadruple consciousness, because there is a tendency sometimes for there to be a flattening or a commodifying of some supposed Black experience or Black vernacular or whatever that might be, and that does concern me. The idea that would be imposed on us, or that we would feel compelled to write from that place because that is what is expected of us by the establishment or even our own community. Rachel, what do you think?
I think that it's kind of like what we said about being obsessed within our own like personal psyches about what we keep coming back to and what we're obsessed with. I think there's certain themes that maybe as a collective we might be obsessed with, or things that we share, because there might be some things in which
our personal psyches overlap and become a cultural one. And that's okay, like we said, it's okay to write about the same thing your whole career. That's what you have to, if that's how the problems come out. But as long as you're changing it up each time, as long as you're making it new, as long as you're staying awake to like being aware that you're not giving a cliched response, that somebody like Kayo said hasn't already written that exactly the same way before. How can you make it new?
Agreed. You don't have to necessarily cut out mangoes or the word melanin from your vocabulary. Rachel.
I'm joking.
I mean, you know. There's vocab that, you know, has become as loaded as the moon, and, you know, other such words that, you know, we've come to feel a little bit embarrassed about using in our poetry. I think it's fun to make fun of, but I agree with you that it's deeper than just having a reflexive dismissal of certain themes or certain words, you know, because it's always about leaning into something, subverting it, borrowing, but then taking it in a different direction. There's always somewhere to go, even with the most played out of notions. So I think you've given some really permission giving responses to that, because I think it's easy to just shit on stuff, isn't it?
If you think like, well, how is that helpful, like for anyone really? Like, even with the mangoes, if you put a mask on the mango or a skull mask and then put sunglasses on it, it's a different poem, you know?
I'll read the hell out of that poem.
Exactly. Yes. Still a mango, though.
It's true. Absolutely. Okay, Kayo, please do share a couple more pieces with us, pretty please.
Sure. So I think I'm going to go for this poem because I haven't... there are loads of poems I haven't read from this collection. But this one I've read it out a few times, but kind of calling out to me at the moment, so I'm going to read it. This is called Epithalamium, and Epithalamium is just a fancy name for a poem written on the occasion of a wedding. And being 33 years old, weddings are a reasonably big part of my life. So this is Epithalamium. There should be a poem to bless the hands that cut and salted a bag of limes, the hands that brought that bag aboard this boat across a body of water we can touch but cannot see. A poem of praise should issue forth from the ether in celebration of an island's nighttime fevers, secular benedictions, shot after shot we drink to the universal language of wavy, turnt up, smashed, passing quervo between us and tentative questions in all we have of each other's words. Me with a mouthful of stock phrases, you fluent almost in this dancing tongue our fellow passengers know, like they know the proper way to nice up a journey home after the dance when the light has faded and the music resounds from a point beyond the horizon. And this boat we boarded guides us, gentle as a hand on a back, to the rest of our lives. I'll read this poem, which I've been thinking a lot recently about list poems and poems in parts, sequences, that kind of thing. So I'm going to read this poem because it's a kind of a celebration of one of the things I'm not experiencing very much now, which is a view of the sea. I don't drive, so driving to the sea is difficult right now. This is called Ocean, not Sinatra. Arguments in favour of the sea. Day clean. Cold day, 1 week after we wed, the woman I love inching in to swim. Water passing over stones sounds like my auntie, weaving family history as if she sat at a loom. 4 years ago, with a man I look like who looks like me, rental bikes, shoreline promenade, denim shirt billowing, the presence of mind to take a picture. Chastising wind, knuckles raw in that first Newcastle winter. Turning to watch the mist clip the top of Table Mountain, 2 years out of university with no job but this wandering to speak in far off rooms. Waterlogged shore road to kill Cregan. Tugboats performing their routine. The switch up, 3 minutes 30 into nights. That October, everything turned in such small moments. Proposals of marriage had become our running joke. That day we returned to the operative words, words you held me to. The tall ships, their figures so prominent in remembrance, it doesn't matter whether I saw them or not. Swing seat in front of a shop selling gelato and agua frescas. Toes brushing sand. Long subway ride. Pensioners trying to slow down time. At some distance, screams from a 100-year-old roller coaster. Sea spray.
When's that collection coming out?
Kind of like the spring of next year, spring 2021 at some point.
Okay. A blood condition. Can we pre-order or not quite yet?
I'm not sure if you can yet. Okay. But it shouldn't be too far off because I've just been, we've just been going back and forth on the cover. It's so close to the period of time when people can see the cover.
Don't compromise until you're happy.
It's exciting. It's exciting. It should be possible to pre-order.
I am very excited to have a copy in my hands for sure. So please do keep an eye out for A Blood Condition coming out next spring. And also Rachel's book, you can get your hands on from August 2020. I am also super hyped for that. And I love the cover for that with the hands behind the back. So striking. I absolutely love it. So I want to give a big, big thank you to Rachel Long, Kayo Chingonyi and SAF-S2E for just giving us a broad, complex, gooey collection of words and sounds. Thank you for your brilliant responses to the quiz. We are still taking offers from esteemed universities for that thesis on the class criticisms around grime instrumentals. We want it, we need it, we will have it. In fact, talk to your peoples at Durham, innit, Kayo? You're already there, you're already in the hallowed halls. So just, you know, make that happen. This has been absolutely brilliant. My name is Vanessa Kisuule. I've been your host.
Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you as well. That's so beautiful to speak to you so chill. Truly like home, isn't it? Like,
yeah. Do you know what? I'm not going to lie. If there was a way to create this same sense of like, I've just rolled out of bed and now I'm listening to poems rather than having to get on the tube or the train or the bus. I think, you know, there's certain things that I definitely want to retain when or if things should go back to normal. But yes, I have been Vanessa Kisuule, your host for Apples and Snakes, take two. It's been an absolute joy. I hope you have found my ridiculousness somewhat amusing, endearing. If not, You know, I'm not everybody's flavor, do you know what I'm saying? But, you know, I'm me. And I have had such a good time. I've just invited poets that I rate. It's been as simple as that, you know? And I cannot wait to listen to the podcast coming up from Apples and Snakes. Be sure to subscribe to this channel to find out more about that. The conversation continues. You'll be hearing from more brilliant poets. And I will be leaving it there. But thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of your evenings and be well, people. Bye.